So do you guys think about that?
Let me ask you guys. So obviously with Orji in and Davis Warren out, it's probably going to, the needle's going to move more toward the run, but Orji's going to have to throw, right? To keep the box light, to keep USC from just ganging up at the line of scrimmage. So what do you think in terms of sequencing? You know, first, I always like to get into first down, second down. You know, do you try and establish the run on first and 10, or do you throw the 6-yard pass on first down to try and get into second and short, medium, manageable? It's going to be a balancing act, because obviously if Michigan can pound the ball for 5 yards on first down, like that's the ideal. But you might have to be throwing on first down at least early in this game in the first quarter to lighten up that tackle box and keep USC guessing. So how do you think the Michigan staff sequences its plays first, second down?
So unfortunately, I think we're going to be predictable. I really do. And the reason why I say that is because we have not seen any creativity of this, of our scheme, of our play calling yet. We've actually seen our coaches put our players so far this season in positions where it kills momentum. They make very poor choices. Now, it does appear, though, they are committing to a quarterback, so we won't see this dual quarterback juggling they were doing earlier in the year against Texas and Fresno State. But my concern, so what I think what we will see on first down, do your prop bets, do whatever. They're running the ball. They're running the ball on first down. You can just, if we see, I'll tell you this though, if we do see creativity out of the coaching staff and they start doing some play action or some nice, short to medium roll or even some rollouts, some strong RPOs, then we're talking. But I just haven't seen it this year, guys. Like, just that's where we are. Like right now, I think the fan base as well as myself, our trust in the coaching staff is a bit dwindled at the moment, and we're just in observation mode trying to understand, are they in over their heads on some of this? Because although I will say this, obviously Shromo was offensive coordinator last year. He coordinated a championship caliber offense. He got the job done, but we are not seeing that creativity this year at all. Like what we did against Alabama. Now again, Orji is a different quarterback than JJ, so it's a bit different. You have to go with different strategies here, but at the same time, the creativity has been lacking. And the feel for the game has been lacking. So it's a bit of a concern on Michigan's end right now.
Yeah, two words. Read option. What I want to happen versus what I think is going to happen are two very different things. What I think is going to happen is read option over and over and over and over again. Sometimes it goes to Orji. Sometimes it's Mullings. Maybe you get lucky and there's a... on Maze Madman last night, we talked about a running back screen that we haven't seen in a long since last year's team with Corum. So there are some things that I think they might go with. A lot of it depends on if Colston Loveland is fully healthy, to be honest with you, because Colston Loveland, I don't know if y'all have been playing College Football 25 or even if you've just watched Colston. Out of everybody in the pass game, he is the one player that consistently gets separation, that consistently is an obvious option for whoever's the quarterback. And you could talk about the other receivers and tight ends as much as you want, but if he's healthy and playing, I think that's when you start to see things open up a little bit, because he can, even with Alex Orji not being the best passer, he can catch the ball with pretty much, I think if some of us go out there, we might be able to throw the ball successfully to Colston Loveland. He's that good. He's 6'5". So I think that he's a big factor. I want to get your guys' take on that too, but I do want to thank Moose, because Moose just gifted 5 memberships. So congratulations to Philip Buford, Jason Bode, Keegan Imhoff, Les Austin, and Tez. Nice. All of you just got Those Who Stay Will Be Champions memberships for 30 days. Congratulations. And thanks to Moose for once again being the Oprah and giving out some memberships for everybody. Really appreciate you, man. And I hope everybody enjoys their membership. I want to kind of dive into the defense. And we've talked a little bit about this on Conquest Call-In Show. I think I asked this question, either called in or asked this question. But we kind of diving into it, it's only been one offseason. However, unlike with Ohio State, unlike with Other programs that have implemented a new defensive system, defensive coordinator. Something remarkable has happened here. I'm gonna give you your flowers. All of a sudden, USC has at least a top 40 defense when they did have a lot. Not so much. Let's be real. They can tackle now. Like players can tackle. There are things that he's doing. I'd love to just get your takes on, you know, maybe a factor from each of you or two factors from each of you on what he's implemented that has caused USC to actually create, you know, stops and cause third down stops and fourth down stops and all that good stuff.
Well, So the issue is not really the tackling and it's not the players. Last year it was really a scheme issue. And I think that Lincoln Riley did a good job talking about this after practice, saying that it's amazing. You know, when you see better tackling, it's not necessarily better technique, although they have been, I've watched them. There's been a lot of emphasis on tackling at practice, but it's really just having guys in position to make plays. You know, you can have a great athlete out there, put them in a bad position, and then they got to make a tackle against a Division I athlete. I mean, I don't know if anyone ever here has tried to tackle someone out in open space. It's not one of the easiest things in the entire world to do. Placing your team in a position to be successful is one of the biggest things that have changed. Another thing that's happened is you've seen the evolution of the coaching and the development. So that is a big portion of the tackling. It's clearly it's been an emphasis for them to get more physical and to work on their tackling. But Riley really downplayed that part of it. He really just said, you know what, the guys are in position, they're making plays. That was maybe his nicest way he could say that last year they didn't know what the hell they were doing. And going back, if we could, though, going back to you guys talked about Colston, is there any word on him? Because here's the thing. I'm wondering if they're going to a more of a run game, because you got your best receiver now, questionable. I'm sure he's going to play. But we all know also, just because he's going to suit up and play doesn't mean he's at 100%. And if you're a receiver, you kind of need that arm. Do you guys have any idea? Like, I'm sure TJ's watched the film. Do you know what's actually probably injured? Is it shoulder, elbow, wrist? What is it?
So I don't know what's injured, but so apparently the injury is less severe than anticipated. And the speculation is he may play this weekend. They don't know. It hasn't been confirmed yet. So he may play. I mean, obviously, this is a major game. So if he's going to play, or if he can play, he will play. I would expect that. But I don't know. The word, I know we have it here. We'll see. Hogan Hansen's going to get an expanded role. That's the backup to the F-type tight end. I mean, I would also anticipate more Marlon Klein. We started to see him last week. There's been a lot of hype out of him, out of camp. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, listen, if he can't play, then our most dynamic offensive threat is eliminated, which is a major problem for us. So, and plus with a quarterback like Alex Orji, a tight end is one of the best matches you can have. So we'll see. I mean, I would say it appears it's like a 60-70% chance he'll play. It appears, but I mean, it's so early to know. It's only Tuesday, so we don't know yet.
I know. Hey, drugs are great. And if it's a pain thing, you can play through it. Drugs are wonderful. Right. But again, at some point, you know, if you are injured and you're receiving quarterback, a tight end, again, a question. I thought right away, again, when I heard Orji was the call, I kind of scratched it. I know that ball security has been an issue, but at the same time, you know, isn't there a reason why, you know, Alex Orji wasn't named the starting quarterback behind multiple quarterbacks during the season? So I'm not sure. I mean, I see a lot of optimism. I'm listening to you guys, but I'm wondering, you know, what is it that you've got you so optimistic about? Because we know how if you go one dimensional against in modern defenses, it's really tough unless you have a super elite offense. Like maybe your offensive line last year could probably lean and do it, but with a questionable offensive line, seemingly going towards a run heavy offense, one dimensional. What is the avenue you see that they could do that and be successful?
TJ, I know you want to hit this one first.
First of all, we were kind of sold a bill of goods during camp. So first of all, there was a lot of hype around Orji, and not only were like it wasn't just things leaking from practice. Every single insider, every single journalist who was getting, because we are, I don't know about USC, how they do practice during fall camp, but it is closed off to anybody. No one can see anything at camp for Michigan. So there was a lot of hype out of Alex Orji looking more polished as a passer, going through his progressions, more comfortable in the pocket. And the word was out of camp all the way up until the final week that Alex Orji was QB1. And then the word is Davis Warren had an astounding final week of camp, 80% completion percentage, 87% is like the actual figure. And he just looked amazing and he stole the job. That was the word out of Ann Arbor, is he stole the job. So they made him QB1. They made Davis Warren QB1. And it's like, well, the speculation or the smoke was, well, it wasn't that Alex Orji lost the job. Alex Orji played really well. Davis Warren just overtook it, right? But then we saw during the game, Tim and Matt, the way they were utilizing Orji, it looked like they don't trust him. So we're very skeptical. As a fan base, we are all skeptical. Like, there's optimism because going into the season, we believe that Alex Orji, many people in the Michigan community, of course, you have your side. Some people are Team Tuttle or Team Warren. But going into the year, majority of us wanted to see Alex Orji because we think he gives us the highest ceiling. Because we saw him actually perform very well in spring ball. And he showed his dual capabilities. And he was actually was throwing at a 70% clip. He looked pretty good. But when he gets into games, the way the coaching staff utilized him, it almost was like they were afraid to call any passing plays. And then he did have one play where he rolled out to the right and he completely threw the ball and it went to the dirt, like 5 feet away from the receiver. So it was very, and then we were like, oh, okay, there's a problem here. So we are, I think as a fan base, we are cautiously optimistic because we believe in the theory of Alex Orji, but we have not seen it come to light yet. And I'll tell you this though, Tim and Matt, if he was truly the guy, he would have started week one. There's a reason it's week. There's a reason it's week four, Big Ten play.
At least we hope. At least we hope that they have enough of an ability to evaluate.
Yeah.
They're putting the right conditions in practice, and we're taking that a little bit on faith because of what they did last year. But we need to remember that, number one, a lot of coaches are now playing in the NFL, either at the Chargers, the Seahawks. I think there's one somewhere else, but a lot of them went to the NFL, and some of the key talent on the offense also did. But I'm talking about coaches because they create the scenarios in practice where these quarterbacks are going up against the ones, the twos, three, and they come up with all of these things in the various days of practice and what drills do they work on and all that kind of stuff. So I'm a little concerned at their ability. I'm going to just say it. I'm a little concerned right now in their ability to pick the guy. And I wasn't, before this season, but I know that Alex Orji, if nothing else, let's say he throws half of his passes into the freaking dirt. Okay. He's not giving them to the other team. That's good. Okay. He's not, and he's running the ball. So I think, let's see what they can draw up. But at the very least, I think he's going to do better. I hope, than three picks. And knock on wood, I'm knocking on the wood right now. But we'll see. I do want to get to three super chats, if you don't mind, guys. Blue Wolverine 999. I really enjoy the mixed panels. We do too, Blue. And we also thank you because, Blue, you have been really awesome on our show. I know Cliff and Mac and others, like you have been out there and we really appreciate you. And that's why you have an emoji. Can everybody drop the blue? If you're a member, you can drop the Blue Wolverine emoji in chat right now. Thank you so much for your 999. GT. $5 here. I think Michigan has to keep USC around 20 points in order to win this game, which is a pretty tall order. I would agree with you, GT. That is a pretty tall order, knowing the offensive, the abilities of Lincoln Riley to play call for Miller Moss, which I commented. Remember in the bowl game, I said, wait a minute. It seems like he's actually calling plays better for Miller Moss than he did at times for Caleb. Like, it just seems to flow so much better with Miller Moss for some reason. So I guess, I'd love to get your guys' take on that super chat. Like, do you think that's the scenario that Michigan has to keep USC to 20 points?
Matt?
I would say this. I think 20 is the number if USC doesn't hand Michigan, you know, a defensive touchdown or special teams touchdown. And I think that really gets to the heart of this game on the most elemental central level. If Michigan has to work hard for all its points, meaning no defensive touchdowns, no special teams touchdowns, and it has to drive 70 or more yards every time, it doesn't get a short field, it doesn't get a kick return, any of that, USC probably wins. But if Michigan can get points from defense and special teams, like then the normal conventional wisdom, you know, how many points Michigan's going to need to hold USC to goes out the window. So really the 20 points holds, the 20 points is pretty much right if USC does not hand deliver any freebies to Michigan.
Yeah, I'm agreeing with Matt. I mean, I was going to save this for our show late in an hour or so, but I mean, since you got a super chat, I'll throw it out there. The keys to the game for me are ball security by SC. If USC takes care of the ball, you know, I think it might be pretty tough for Michigan to win this game. I'm that's how I feel. SC can't settle for field goals. SC has been sloppy in the red zone with penalties, drop balls, and ended up costing about 10 points against LSU. They can't do that because points can be a premium. Everyone's writing off, not everyone. There are many people in the nation writing off Michigan's defense, and they're crazy. This is a solid defense. It's going to test USC. And then the last thing's penalties. Like Matt just said, we can't help out Michigan's offense by extending plays with dumb penalties and vice versa. We can't make dumb mistakes against a good defense ending drives on offense. So if SC plays a clean game and they score, you know, more than 20 points, I would find it very difficult for Michigan to win this game, in my opinion.
Okay. TJ?
No, I mean, I think if we can hold USC to 20 points, then that's definitely a path to victory. And I agree with Tim here, where if USC plays a clean game, no turnovers, no bad penalties, I do find it a far more steeper climb for Michigan to get this victory, given what we've seen. Now, hopefully week four, we see a team going into Big Ten play who's extremely motivated with a fire under their ass because they have a lot to prove. You know, they know in the locker room, they know what's being said. So, you know, it's on them to step up this week and really make a statement to the world, because this is going to be a primetime game here. Like everyone's going to be watching USC Michigan. You know what I mean? So we're looking at a heavyweight matchup in theory. We'll see if Michigan comes to the plate. I mean, I'm less concerned about USC. Well, I'm concerned about USC, but for this to be the heavyweight matchup, we think it has the potential to be. I think USC is coming to play. I just hope Michigan is as well. That's the concern, because we have seen Michigan, unfortunately, falter to another elite juggernaut in college football right now, and that's Texas. So, but I think if Michigan can hold them to 20, we have a great opportunity to get the victory.
Yeah, that word if Michigan can hold USC to 20, that word if is doing a lot of lifting, given what Miller Moss is able to do. And there was a comment, I think, from a USC fan earlier that said, watch out for USC's tight ends, because everybody always talks about the wide receiver talent. And of course, we all know that Lincoln Riley can coach, you know, he can get quarterbacks coached up to a very elite level. And we know that the wide receiver talent's there. But I thought that comment was extremely interesting, because I don't normally think USC tight ends. But that comment was in there, and I would love to just hear your take on that. Like, you know, how does Miller Moss need to feed the receivers and the tight ends here to win in the pass game?
Want me to go, Matt?
Sure.
In the pass game, yeah, it's well, you saw two things. You saw especially in the game, where you have both, when you have, they've been running with the run game. They've been putting in, they're doing two. It's not 12 personnel, because you have Lake McCree lined up in the backfield. Really, it's like a 21 on. And then you got an H back, depending on who's going to be slotted out. So they're using that to run. But as a whole, you saw, if you drop your safeties back, Miller will pick you apart over the middle, right? And he'll just drop it right in. And if you try to stack the line, their athlete, you know, Lake McCree has shown that, that he's athletic enough to go out and make catches. Yeah, I mean, recently, this is the most we've seen Riley use his tight ends. Late in the Helton era, the tight ends just disappeared. But, I mean, throughout history, USC's had solid tight end play. But as of recent, I would have to say, yeah, probably not. But if you have Eldridge and Lake McCree,
wow.
That way they got it lined up, it's pretty impressive.
like that's a tight end has the most receiving yards out of every personnel on here. That's pretty cool. I mean, it's definitely something I wasn't expecting and really impressive.
One thing for me to add on in all this is that, you know, if you watch that LSU game closely, USC did a lot of wide receiver screens and like short hitch patterns, really quick stuff outside the numbers to give Miller Moss just some easy completions. You know, it was week one, just get him into a rhythm, just easy pitch and catch. LSU began to really bite down on those wide receiver screens on the edges. And you saw USC then go to the tight end along the hash marks in the middle third of the field as the mid-game adjustment to LSU biting down on the wide receiver screens. So it was not like the first point of attack against LSU. It was an adjustment to LSU coming up hard on the outside, on the boundaries. So it's going to be interesting to see how Lincoln Riley, who, you know, he makes defenses account for the full width and length of the field. And so how, whether the tight end is like his first attack point or whether it's an adjustment, you know, it's a secondary attack point that, you know, flows from the first attack point, that's going to be a natural plot point for this game in terms of how USC goes at Michigan's defense.
I've got a couple more super chats here. Tim, prepare thyself for Nick's $1.99 kamikazes, as he likes to do. Usually it's to the Buckeyes, to be fair. Okay, 99% of them are to the Buckeyes. But in this case, obviously with USC week, Tim, you ready to get whipped Saturday? USC is so soft. Wow. I don't think they're as soft as third base Ryan Day.
That's a 2023 thing. USC ain't soft no more.
I don't think so.
I think Nick's been drinking too many of his own 199 kamikazes. I think that's Nick's problem. And, you know, I'll tell you, Nick, a lot of people told us, not just LSU fans, but the national media, how soft we were and how LSU is going to run the ball down our throat. That was literally what people were saying. And you know what? That's also what you guys said in 2007. I'm just going to leave that right there as well. How they're going to come out and beat the Surfer Boys. That didn't work out too well for your quarterback. Was it Henny? I don't know if it was Henny. I can't remember who said this comment. So, I mean, hey, look, you know what? Who knows? They play the game on the field. Maybe you guys will come take it to us, but history hasn't been kind to people that talk smack like that to USC.
Rarely does Vegas move its opinion on anyone. It takes a lot for Vegas to move its opinion, and the entire offseason has been Michigan's going to maintain elite status. USC's kind of a wild card. They're on the fringe of the top 25. Sure, there's talent. There's Lincoln Riley. There's all these components we are not sure about. But Michigan is this stalwart, this rock-solid team that's coming into the season to contend again in the Big Ten. And sure, we're going to see mass movements down deep into the season, but we're only into week three. And the position on pundits, Vegas, everyone has completely flip-flopped on these two teams from Michigan being probably a 7 to 10-point favorite in the offseason to USC pushing over a touchdown favorite on Saturday, Matt.
That's pretty shocking. Not that USC's favored, but pushing a touchdown. Because I saw, like a week ago, FanDuel had a early line of 2.5. So like that's just insane line movement just within the course of a week that's being bet all the way up. And I think that, you know, I didn't mention this on the Michigan show. I guess I'm saving this for the USC show. No, that's not really true. But just the thought comes to mind now. I should have thought about it on the Michigan show with John and TJ. But, you know, Lincoln Riley, when he was at Oklahoma, remember the game against Ohio State? I believe that was a week 3 game in the middle of September. So, you know, You don't empty the kitchen sink in week one or week two. Keep a few things under wraps. Lincoln Riley ran rings around Ohio State middle second half of that game in Columbus, you know, the one with Baker Mayfield planting his flag on the turf in Ohio Stadium in the horseshoe. And the thought does occur to me, Lincoln Riley's sitting on a lot of goodies. And he's had 2 weeks to prepare for this game. So like that certainly is a reason for USC fans to feel optimistic that there's going to be things that Wink Martindale and the Michigan defensive staff have not seen on film. You got to think that Lincoln Riley is going to be setting up some plays, not just keeping them under wraps for the game, but also he's going to do things in the first quarter that are going to set things up for late second, early third quarter. So, you know, it's going to be fun to see what Lincoln Riley does in terms of manipulating the Michigan defense in this game.
I think it would be fun for me to ask TJ, how is USC going to win this game? And ask Tim, how is Michigan going to win this game?
Well, the way USC can win this game is if they
show up.
The way they can win is stop the run. If they are able to suppress Michigan's ability to run the ball, and they get Michigan to have some three and outs or short drives, one, that's going to completely disrupt the offense. And then secondly, our defense is going to be on the field. They're going to be overexhausted, overworked. We saw this against Texas. Texas was able to achieve this by the second quarter because Michigan, one, couldn't get off on third down. And then we were having enough offensive issues where we could not sustain drives. So do not allow Michigan to sustain drives. Stop the run. And then capitalize on your offensive opportunities. And we talked about this previously on the show I was on, but if they can score touchdowns and not resort to field goals, then it's going to be a long day for Michigan.
So before we let Tim go on this one other side note to that is obviously the wild card status of an Alex Orji in regards to what is he going to bring to the offense. We know he's not a thrower, so we're not expecting, you know, Drew Bledsoe-esque type style quarterbacking out of Alex Orji. We know what his strengths are, but at the same time, there could be an advantage there on the Michigan side that there's nothing on tape about Alex Orji other than him taking a direct snap and running with it a little bit more than that. They've thrown him a few times, some intermediate or not even intermediate, some stuff in the flat. But TJ, you are about as well-equipped to answer this question than anybody I know. What would you do with Alex Orji? How much you would, let's say it's a competitive game. You know, you can't just trample them up front and just run the ball at will. So you got to mix in the pass. You got to be balanced. Like, what can we expect out of Alex Orji in terms of being a downfield throwing threat?
Well, Alex Orji does have the capability to do short and intermediate passes. We have actually seen this. I mean, we saw this in the spring game. He was at a 70% clip against our defense. He looked good enough. He looked capable at throwing these passes. So what they need to do with Alex Orji is, one, they need to definitely scheme the playbook to his strengths. And by doing that, I believe some RPOs, some play action, rolling out to the right. I'm not too sure how he is rolling out to the left because the sample size is so small. I don't know his capabilities there. I actually am not overly confident with that, but I do believe if they can establish that along with an effective run game, that should keep USC honest. Now, you will need to do the occasional deep shot, and we do have some players that you can do it with. We have Fred Moore. We have Samaj Morgan. These are players, and another player that they started on unwrap against Arkansas State, which is Amarion Walker, who is he might be a 4-3 guy. He has, last year he was tested to have the highest three cone drill, and he would have had the number one score in the NFL combine. That's how athletically gifted he is. He's a 6'4 wide receiver. We got him out of Ole Miss. He transferred from Ole Miss. So he's extremely gifted athlete. His problem is he's still learning the position. He's a little raw, but we may see him out there to try and at least maybe be a diversion, keeping USC a little honest, spreading the field a little bit. But the way that they need to capitalize on Alex Orji is these quick pass options that should achieve a high completion percentage, or at least a higher percentage of a successful play.
Tim, if you were scheming for Michigan against USC, what would you do?
Well, on defense, USC has shown that they've had some trouble on the line and pass protection. That's why I think it's important for USC to be able to run the ball and play balance there. USC, so if they could try to limit, like TJ was saying, try to limit our run game, try to make us throw, and then allow guys to come at USC and to attack USC. You know, have like Grant, Graham, and Stewart come at USC and get a pass rush. That's really where it's gonna happen, because USC's had some issues with ball security and we've lucked out. I mean, you know, the ball is shaped funny for a reason, and sometimes it bounces the right way, and it's bounced the right way for USC. If USC doesn't play a clean game and they're able to frustrate us in the run game and get a pass rush, that's Michigan's best. They're not going to win on offense, but they sure could make it difficult on defense. So that's really where this game will be decided for Michigan.
Well, I'll add to that. Like, the thing for Michigan right now is getting pressure on the quarterback. We got one sack on Arkansas State, and they were down an offensive lineman. We got zero sacks against Texas. Now, granted, it's arguably the best offensive line in the nation, but even so, Michigan's defensive line should be able, considering they have two potential first-round picks on that defensive line, they should be able to get pressure. We've also seen this year that has been a little concerning, a lack of push up the middle with Kenneth Grant and Mason Graham. And we're also wondering, where is the creativity on defense? Because we are not seeing creativity with blitz packages or disguises on the back end with coverage disguises like we're used to seeing with Jesse Minter and Mike McDonald. So there are concerns on our end. Now, hopefully they get these things corrected, and by week four, by this game this Saturday, that these things will be more polished. We'll see. But these are concerns so far entering the season.
You know, that's TJ. I was going to ask you this. It made me think about when I was actually on the show with you earlier. I have my thoughts on it, but who do you think this team misses more, Jesse Minter or Jim Harbaugh?
Probably Jim Harbaugh. I mean, Jesse Minter's was an upgrade over Mike McDonald, which is saying a lot. We're seeing that in the NFL right now. I mean, the Chargers defense looks great. Seattle, I mean, these dudes are translating to the NFL. These are NFL caliber coordinators and coaches. But Harbaugh's, as quirky as he is, as unique as he is just an excellent football coach, and he keeps a program strong. There's a reason why he's already 2-0 with the Chargers. You know, he's just an excellent football coach.
I'm just kidding. Sorry. Go ahead.
J.K. Dobbins, maybe. But yeah, no, I understand. But like, no, I mean, he's just a great coach. I mean, and here's the thing too. If Jim Harbaugh was the head coach, I would assure you we would have had probably a better replacement at coordinator than Wink Martindale. Well, we'll see. It's still to be determined. It's early in the year. We'll see what Wink can do.
All right, Tim. You were more optimistic about SEC season than either Matt or I, although I don't think either one of us are surprised. They beat LSU. I picked them to win that game. They won it impressively. They also didn't just slop through Utah State. They did what an elite team does. They stomped them, and they shut them out on defense to further confirm the defensive improvement. And now they haven't played Michigan yet, but they look in position to be the better team and be a decided favorite. Could you have envisioned this is just about as good as it could be entering week three, not just for USC, but the circumstances of this game, that Michigan is apparently off of its game?
It is a combination of both those things, really. I'm a bit surprised. I'd be lying if I said that I thought that this defense would look this good. I'm beyond impressed with just because of the turnaround. But as far as USC being in the position it's in, the reason why I was bullish on USC, and I said it, I don't know how many times, going back even to when we had a defensive coordinator that I didn't really feel confidence for, I kept saying that, and I said a lot in the summer because nobody was really believing it. They talked about it for years. They said, what if Lincoln Riley had a decent defensive coordinator? And one thing I did know is that we'd have a decent defense. So why was I so high on USC? It was because I knew we had a decent defense coming in. And I know you just Lincoln Riley is the best play caller in football, in college football, definitely. And you put him with a competent defensive coordinator. We saw what he did, you know. So then say, well, can he do it 1 year? Well, we saw what he did at UCLA, turning a program that was horrific on defense and turning them into one of the better run defenses in the country and one of the better overall defenses in the country. We saw it firsthand as Trojan fans, the way he basically shut out Lincoln Riley. And Lincoln Riley looked at that and says, if you could do that to my offense, I want you as my defensive coordinator. And they went across town and they grabbed him. And I didn't think Michigan would be struggling the way it is. Again, I'm so surprised. Maybe I just spoiled being a USC fan. Because no matter how bad we are, we always have a great quarterback. It doesn't matter how bad we are on other parts of the field. For some reason, USC always has an elite level quarterback. No matter how bad we try to shoot ourselves in the foot in other parts of the program. And so you add that to Lincoln Riley, bringing a competent defense. These guys are playing out of their minds. They're all very talented, but they're playing. It's just a message. They seem very keyed in. Every interview I've been a part of and around, these guys are just singular focused. We don't care about the outside noise. You know, some of it's coach speak. Some of it's being coached up by the sports information, you know, on how to talk and how to talk to this press. But these kids believe it. And I think that they screwed up, they being the rest of the country, taking shots at Lincoln Riley, embarrassing Lincoln Riley and embarrassing these players. And now they're mad and they're coming back for it. So I'm glad to see it. I think the combination of USC's defense being as good as it is and the opponents that we thought was going to be a huge gauntlet to run through, looking mortal, if not staggered, it has me really excited about what USC can do this year.
There's another point to add here in all of this, and that is that, you know, USC against Utah State was supposed to be facing Spencer Petras, instead faced Bryson Barnes. Okay, was supposed to face Davis Warren, now instead is going to be facing Alex Orji. Next week, supposed to face Tyler Van Dyke, instead will face Braden Locke. So USC is going to have a run of three straight games in which a team is going to change its starting quarterback. Now, in two of the three cases, it's injury. In one of the three cases, it's a choice by the coaching staff. But nevertheless, USC is running into quite the series of plot twists with opposing quarterbacks. It's pretty fascinating to contemplate that. And that's just 1 month, not even half a season, let alone a full season.
And the defense is still, they talked about in the offseason, the way that he's been successful at UCLA, he being Danton Lynn, has been successful at UCLA and now appears to have it turned around here at USC and with great momentum, is the fact that he installed it and they just would nail parts of the offense. He didn't throw the whole gigantic playbook at them. They're getting the stuff down, the fundamentals, and he's adding stuff every week. So this defense, just like in any install, is going to get better every week the more they get familiar with the scheme. And Miller Moss, I'm saying it again, Miller Moss is special. He's going to keep getting better every single week, every rep at practice, every time he throws the ball or takes a snap in the game. The young man's going to get better and better. And he's so far he's shown he's got ice water. He's taking some hits. We need to protect him. That's the key to the season, is he's got to stop taking those hits because, you know, it's football.
Do you think Miller Moss stays after the year?
That's a question for him, his agent, and his family.
Okay. I didn't know if you guys had a pulse on
that. Okay. Yeah, no, it's early, but I mean, he keeps playing like this. I doubt it.
Okay. You know what, TJ? I would say this. Let's check in after the Michigan game.
No, I think his stock will go up throughout the year. That's what I will say. Now, I'll make that prediction. I don't think that it's not. I think it's going to be a situation of, you know, I can't imagine it getting much better than if he continues to play the way he's playing right now. I can't imagine his stock going up, staying for a senior year. I think it would be really he's shown what he can do, and then now he just has to go to the next level. Would be my guess, but. I mean, obviously that's the decision they're going to make.
You know, it's potentially possible you guys make a good run here in the playoffs, and maybe he wants, he got to taste the playoffs, and, you know, maybe with a nice NIL package, he could return for a redemption tour, you know, kind of like Quinn Ewers is going through. JJ went through it. We'll see. I mean, obviously to be determined, but it's
a long way away. Yeah.
Let's I mean, you guys look like a playoff team, though. I mean, you got to be feeling. I mean, maybe you guys are being cautiously optimistic, but you know, from an outsider's perspective, you guys look like a playoff team.
I think they look like a complete team, and I think they've got playmakers and they've got elite coaching. That's a good combination for a playoff team. I agree with you, TJ.
If you had to pick like one or two things that you think are going to drive a USC victory, we'll start with Matt because I know Tim chimed in a little bit already, but we'll go to you as well. But Matt, what do you think USC needs to do to beat Michigan here?
So the thing I've already said, and it requires no elaboration at all, just don't give Michigan any freebies or cheapies. That's number one. But beyond that, USC's offensive line has to stand up to Michigan's defensive line. And obviously dominating would be great, but play to a draw. You know, don't get beaten outright. Like, make sure that it's a pretty even fight in the trenches. Because if we say that it's an even battle, you know, that means that, you know, Michigan's not consistently caving the pocket. Michigan's not consistently creating negative plays. That USC is in, you know, second and medium, third and, you know, if not short yardage, maybe just 3 or 4 yards, such that, you know, you can just throw a 3 or 4 yard pass to move the sticks. As long as USC's offensive line can at least play to a draw against Michigan's defensive front, it likely points to, you know, Miller Moss not being too uncomfortable. It points to USC having some degree of time of possession and therefore field position as well. You know, you're at least getting 2-3 first downs a drive. You know, you punt the ball and you put Michigan inside its own 15-yard line. That gets back to what I've said. If you make Michigan drive 80 yards and you don't hand deliver Michigan any cheap points or short fields, USC, you know, if that's the kind of game that's played, USC probably wins. So it really goes to USC's offensive line, because I love this USC defense. You know, you asked earlier, what's been the change? Well, you know, we went from having a completely incompetent staff to a very professional staff. I mean, that's really the long and short of it. And I'm sold on this staff. And you know, it's not blind faith either, because we saw Danton Lynn transform a pretty average group of UCLA players into a good, tough, physical defense. And by the way, let's talk about UCLA just for a moment to underscore how great Danton Lynn was.
I know where you're going.
UCLA just got dump trucked by Indiana, losing by 29 at home, giving up 42 points. You know, Danton Lynn, that game probably would have been 13-13 getting into the final few minutes. So, like, the regression we've instantly seen at UCLA only magnifies Danton Lynn even more. So again, it's not blind faith in Danton Lynn. There's already a track record that he's accumulating. So I'm sold on USC's defense and its ability to contain Michigan, as long as the USC offensive line can do a reasonably good job. Doesn't have to hit it out of the park. You know, doesn't have to be Miggy Cabrera 2013. As long as USC, you know, hits a solid double and can, you know, pretty much play even against Michigan's defensive front, I'm pretty confident of a USC victory. But I do need to see this offensive line on the road in the Big House perform up to that standard.
Yeah, I liked what Victor Rocha said, and kind of go along with, I mean, I already told you guys what my keys were, but Matt, I like what you said, but I'd even go a step further. You know, the thing USC has to watch out for is we're talking about Michigan. We're talking about the defensive line. And if you're going to have a defensive line where you're going to let Graham and Grant just kind of take over the game, that's the key to victory for Michigan. And so Victor was saying, do you think the SC is going to run the ball more? And I think that you have to keep Michigan honest. If they can pin their ears back and come after Miller, Matt, like you said, they don't have to win the battle. I mean, what they got to do is just not let Michigan dominate the battle. If they, like you said a stalemate, you know, play them to the middle, you know, just kind of hold them off, then yeah, I mean, that's good. Or even just lose slightly the battle, but just don't let those guys play like the NFL studs that they're going to be and just kind of run Miller. You know, I'm visions of like Notre Dame last year with Caleb, where just the offensive line was just folding. This offensive line is not giving us any inclination that that's going to be the case in any game this year. But this is probably going to be a hell of a test for them. And if they could play it to, like you said, to a draw or just maybe concede a little bit, but not let them take over this game and run the ball and play balanced football, then that's also going to be very important. So, yeah, I think you're right on that.
Yeah, so my three keys of the game are, especially for Michigan, is sustained drives for a dual purpose. One, keeping our defense off the field. Giving our defense time to rest, and then keeping Miller Moss off the field, Lincoln Riley's offense off the field. The more that is, the better. The other one is we need pressure. Last week we got one sack against Arkansas State, against that porous offensive line of Arkansas. We got one sack with our defensive line. The week prior we got zero sacks against Texas. We have got to get pressure. We have got to get to Miller Moss to make him uncomfortable. And then my last key to victory is we have to hold them to field goals. We cannot allow touchdowns. So if we can at least hold them to preferably three and outs and no points, but if we are going to allow them to get some form of points, let's hold them to field goals. If we can do that, I do believe Michigan can come out with the victory.
USC has dropped, like flat out dropped or had not secured the ball, by my count, at least 4 to 5 times this year. Two of those times they ended up scoring a touchdown, but it's a couple, you know, it was close. The other times they did have to settle for field goals. It should have been touchdowns. That's why Miller Moss, I believe he has like one or two touch. I think he has two touchdown passes on the season. That stat is broken. He should have 5 to 6, but
I agree.
I mean, that's why you play the game. You got to make the plays. And like you said, TJ, if SC is settling for field goals, I said that too. I said, you can't settle for field goals. You got to push it for touchdowns. That's going to be key for this game for both teams.
Yeah, one thing to even dive more, you guys mentioned earlier the red zone issues, that there were actually some red zone issues on USC's offense. One thing Wink Martindale needs to do is to stop substituting so much, and especially in the red zone. I understand you need to rest guys, and I get that. And hopefully Alex Orgie and Khalil Mullings and the O-line, and hopefully Crippen starts. They can just kind of keep the defense a little bit more rested. But in the red zone, you can't put the second string in against USC. It's not going to work. It didn't even work against Arkansas freaking State. So you really can't do it against USC. So I think that's the biggest one. Wink Martindale just needs to do a better job of personnel management. And if he does that, and he can obviously, dial up some more exotic pet looks, then I think we're onto something. What I've seen so far, so I think they need to pull some things that we just haven't seen yet, to be honest.
TJ, so what, for Michigan, what are the keys to a Michigan win?
Yeah, so the keys for Michigan to achieve a victory on Saturday is they must sustain drives offensively. They cannot have three and outs. They have to sustain drives for two reasons. One, allowing our defense to get rest and not get exhausted by going against the Lincoln Riley offense and the Miller Moss passing attack. And then the other variable there is allowing Miller Moss to not be on the field. If we do not allow Miller Moss to be on the field, Miller Moss cannot score. That is a key. We have to do that. The other key to the game, which we did touch on, was Michigan must get pressure. If Michigan does not get pressure on Miller Moss, it is going to be a long day. It is going to be a day similar to Texas, is what my concern is, if we do not dial up pressure. Because the reason why that's going to be is we're going to, one, get tired, which when you're going in a track meet with an offense like this, that's a very bad recipe for success. If you are exhausted going against a high octane offense, especially with an elite passer that we're looking at in Miller Moss, that's deadly. So we cannot allow that to happen. We must get pressure. We must disrupt their offense, get them out of rhythm, disrupt the flow. And then my last key is if they do sustain drives, we have to hold them field goals. We cannot allow 7, because I do think Michigan is going to have some challenge scoring. Now, will they score? Yes. How much will they score? That's the question. What is this offense's potential with Alex Orgie? It's to be seen, so we don't fully know yet. But what I do know is if we can at least hold them to 3, and that allows Michigan to get, if they can get 7 on their drives, that'll make Michigan a far more competitive opponent for USC this Saturday.
TJ, do we know the health status of Colston Loveland? And if he can't go, It looked like the tight ends filled in pretty well last week, but what does the depth chart look like?
Yep. So Hogan, or I'm sorry. So Colson Loveland is the injury is less serious than originally expected. I would say there's about a 60 to 70% chance he plays. It's still unsure because practice, there hasn't been anything that really has leaked from practice yet, but I would say we're at 60, 70%. If Colson Loveland is unable to play, expect Hogan Hansen to fill the inline blocker role, and then expect Marlon Klein to do more of the Y tight end position, where he's going to be split out into the slot or potentially even in the X role. Marlon Klein is a tight end that we have been talking about a lot this offseason as a name to know, because he runs a 10-8 100 meter at 6'4", 250. He has been said by Kirk Campbell, who has coached Pat Freiermuth. He's coached obviously Colson Loveland and a few other prominent name tight ends. He has said that Marlon Klein is the most athletic tight end he has ever coached. He's more athletic than Colson Loveland. Now, it does not make him better than Colson Loveland. Obviously, it's more than just athletic ability, but he is an up-and-coming name that we are hoping that becomes a name this season.
This is another angle that fascinates me, and Tim and Matt could probably correct me on making this comparison, but USC seems like it's a pretty similar offense in regards to skill level, the quarterback, the style of quarterback play to Texas. They seem pretty comparable in a lot of ways. You know, Tim highlighted that the USC offensive line is not as good as Texas's. You could say that the USC wide receiver room is probably a little bit better than Texas. We could make all sorts of little adjustments, but they seem to be stylistically, athletically, very similar. Their quarterbacks are not runners, they're throwers, they're precision passers. Again, the game that Miller Moss put out there against LSU is one of the most impressive quarterback displays, considering his lack of experience, in addition, that I've seen in a long time. And so is Michigan smart enough, Sharon Moore and his coaching staff? I wouldn't have been hesitant about this in previous years with Jim Harbaugh at the helm, to self-scout and to say, you know, we're going to see something similar. Of course, there are different nuances, but we're looking at two elite play callers and offensive technicians in Sark and Lincoln Riley. That can we clean up how we got shredded when Texas came to town?
Well, that's one of the big questions for us as Michigan fans, because we are not seeing self-scouting or self-reflection right now. We see it almost looks like they're trying to force things. They're not. We have some issues on Michigan right now that the fan base thinks we like. The fan base feels confident in the answer, but the coaching staff is showing us through results that they don't agree with what the fan base is seeing. I'll give you an example. We believe majority of the fan base would say Khalil Mullins should be RB1. Well, the coaching staff appears to want to make Donovan Edwards RB1, but it's quite clear that Khalil Mullins is the better back at center. Greg Crippen looks like the better player, but like Sharon Moore just made a comment today that they graded Dominic Giudice higher, which is crazy because I've watched the game twice, and Crippen, when he's out there, the offense actually performs better. There's more push, more gaps. It actually looks a lot better with Crippen out there. So I don't know what he's seeing. And then we have an issue at right tackle. So there are these issues that we're not seeing the coaching staff identify. Like, it appears they're not recognizing. It just seems an inexperienced coach like Sharon Moore, what we're finding is he doesn't have a feel for the program. That is a concern right now. Now it's early. The sample size is small, but that's the early read. And a lot of fans in the fan base right now are getting a little concerned about it. So are we self-scouting from Texas to USC? I hope, but I don't know yet. The sample size is so small on what we're getting, but the coaching staff, and I've made this announcement to our community, has lost my trust. I do not trust our coaching staff. They have not shown us through from spring portal, from spring ball all the way to the start of the year, that they have a pulse of the program and that they are identifying strengths and weaknesses or putting players in the best position to succeed. Because that's another issue. Why is Donovan Edwards not being utilized in the slot? Why is Colson Loveland not being put in the X position? Because he'd be an optimal. He can play X. He can do that. You can use Marlon Klein as your inline tight end, or Hogan Hansen. There are ways to utilize these players to be better, or putting your best players on the field. We're not seeing it, and we don't know why. Like, many in the fan base are actually in agreement with what we think is ideal, and Sharon Moore is doing the opposite on some of these.
I think in terms of drilling deep on a comparison between the USC offense and Texas offense, I think one of the things is that Texas's offensive line set a very high standard. I don't think USC is going to match that standard, but I will say if USC can come even modestly close, you know, that's probably going to be good enough. And on our Michigan show with TJ and John, Tim and I both were in agreement that, you know what, USC doesn't have to dominate Michigan's defensive line up front. Just don't get dominated. Pretty much play it even, prevent the negative plays, make sure Miller Moss has enough time to throw. Because, like, if you use the LSU game as a parallel, you know, USC didn't dominate in the run game. USC didn't really run block all that well against LSU. But for the most part, Miller Moss was clean. Now, Miller Moss was throwing the ball fairly quickly, but nevertheless, like in 2-minute drills, late half drives, he generally had enough time to throw. And so if we get that kind of situation where, you know, this is not one-way traffic, the pocket isn't always caving in on Miller Moss, and he generally has enough time and space to make the kind of throws that he made against LSU, and he made a lot of great throws. If he gets a reasonable amount of time and he's not overwhelmed the way Caleb Williams has been with the Bears behind that Swiss cheese offensive line, you know, if Miller Moss has a fundamental comfort level, that should be good enough for USC. Won't guarantee it, but like that would be certainly a step forward for USC if Miller Moss has pretty much the same amount of time he had against LSU, maybe a little bit more since this is a true road game. But fundamentally, like if that bar gets set pretty much where it was set against LSU, should be good enough against Michigan.
Yeah, I think that's a key. Like, does Michigan get pressure on Miller Moss? Do they make him uncomfortable? Are they able to push up the middle and affect the pocket? Now, we have had one sack in 2 weeks. That's where we are with this defensive line. This defensive line that is featuring two potential first-round picks and then two returners who are arguably starters last year on our defense in Josiah Stewart and Derek Moore. And then we have an up-and-comer in TJ Guy that everyone's very high on. So can they get it together? Can Wink Martindale dial up effective blitzes and coverages to, because you can get coverage sacks too, right? So can they dial it up correctly to make Miller Moss uncomfortable? That is going to be an extremely important key to this game.
We're going to start with Matt himself. We got Matt here. Fight on. How you doing?
Ready for game week. This is going to be fun. And, you know, I've listened to you for the past 10, 15 minutes. Didn't listen at the very start of the show, but caught you the past 10 minutes. Lots of solid observations. I think that, the point about LSU not looking very good, like, yeah, we have to take that into context with USC, you know, just how good is that LSU win? I mean, obviously it was a great win to start the season, and like LSU does have a lot of talent, but LSU is not well coached. And also LSU's offensive line, which, you know, guys in Louisiana were saying, this is the best offensive line I've ever seen. Well, that was a preseason observation, and it definitely hasn't held up well. So that goes into, you know, a recalibration of matchups in the trenches, which, you know, in my mind are going to be front and center in this game. Pun not intended. Like that's where this game's going to be won or lost. Does Miller Moss get time? Does he get a clean pocket on the road in the big house? Does he get a comfort zone? Or does that Michigan defensive line, which, you know, got a real education from Texas, does that, you know, but like that could help Michigan, right? You went up against the best. Like
Texas number one in the country. Yeah.
Texas looks the part, and that could be the best thing for Michigan going into this game. So my view is I'm expecting a slugfest. I'm expecting a rock fight. Like this could be Woody versus Bo 1973.
Absolutely.
That kind of game.
Well, let's see what,
be,
you know,
it could be your grandfather's 3 yards in a cloud of dust. on Saturday afternoon. So, you know, I'm seeing lots of people pick USC 30-17, 33-18, you know, 34-20. I'll take the ugliest 13-12 win you've ever seen and will ride out of town a happy man.
Well, let's see what Mr. Tim Pringley, let's see if he agrees. Bo versus Woody. How about that? Tim Prangley of host also Trojan Conquest Live coming up in about an hour and a half. Conquest call-in show and Trojans Wire. Tim, thanks for joining us, man.
No, thanks for having me on. Appreciate it. Well, I don't know about Bo versus Woody because I don't think Woody had the receivers that USC has. So I think this is not going to be a slugfest, Matt. I think this game will be decided through the air. I do think that USC has the better athletes on the outside. Will Johnson's awesome. I have nightmares of Miller Moss throwing some of those balls in a flat he's got away with earlier this season that he easily could have possibly just out of reach of the defensive backs from going for six the other way. I don't think that he'll have that room with Will Johnson, especially, but I'm not sure if it's gonna be a slugfest. No, Matt, I'm not sure on that one. We'll see. Matt's usually right, but I'm not seeing
your boy. Your boy Adam, who you both know very well, and he comes on to our channels too and supports, and great dude. Has defended Michigan in various instances, but this week he's fight on, and I'd be the same way. So I got him. $20 here. USC will wear down the Michigan defense, which, while good, doesn't have the same depth as last year, and accordingly will get fatigued. That's the difference. So he's already giving his prediction. We're not. You're a little ahead of us, Adam, but that's okay because you gave $20. So that's fine. But he's giving his prediction 30-17. So what do you think? What do you? Let's get TJ's take first, and then we'll get your guys' take on that comment.
Well, I'll say this: we all saw against Texas something we're not used to seeing. And that was a defense who was exhausted in the second quarter. We're not used to that. Our defense actually never gets exhausted, but we're starting to see signs of that this year, which is very interesting. There is a bit lack of depth. They've tried to rotate guys. So for example, against Texas, we put in our backup defensive lineman and they got pushed off the ball. Now we do have Rayshon Benny. He's very good. So we have about three defensive tackles we can rely on right now, but, against Arkansas State, we put in our second unit, and those are our second unit's the ones who gave up all those points at the end of the game. So we are very reliant on our starters right now. We also are seeing our defense get gassed, which I'm not used to seeing. So if this is a track meet like Tim Pringley is forecasting, then we could be in for a defense that is exhausted. And this is why it is key that Michigan sustains drives and stays on schedule. Because against Texas, in the very beginning of the game, we kept stalling. And then eventually our defense wore down and our defense could not stop them on third down. If we can attempt to get USC off the field and we can sustain drives, then that is when it will be a ball game. If we do not do that, then Tim's probably going to be accurate in his prediction.
So we're at the point in our previews where we give our predictions. And so I know that earlier in the show, we gave kind of the five keys for the Michigan side. You guys gave your take on what you think is going to happen. Would love to just hear what your thoughts are on how the game is going to go. I'll let you guys tackle it either one.
Go ahead, Tim.
Well, I'm assuming, like I said, my keys to the game, the SC plays clean, right? Penalty wise, which they've done for the majority of this season. There's some misconception. There's a person in the chat that's confused with 93% scoring in the red zone. That includes field goals. So what my comment was is SC can't settle for field goals. They need to punch it in for touchdowns and that people are dropping the ball. So Just to clarify that, your stat is a great stat. And we all know that SC is scoring 37 points per game. This offense isn't struggling. The point is that you're playing a solid defense on the road in a hostile crowd, and you're not going to be able to get away with drops in this game. I think that USC has to punch it in and not settle for four or five field goals they need to get touchdowns. So I hope that clarifies it for the chat. As far as a score, how I think the game's going to go out, I think it's going to be your typical game between two very talented teams. I think it's going to be a little bit of a feeling each other out in the first quarter. And, you know, there's going to be some growing pains, probably even some little bit conservative play. But I do think if USC plays a clean game, the final score, I think USC is going to hold, actually, because, you know, that running's great, but once you get in that red zone, running the ball, it might be an issue for Michigan. I see a lot of field goals. So I'm going with, I'm giving my prediction now and not my show. Fine, I'll say it. USC is going to win this game 27-16, I think, is the final score.
Okay.
What do you got, final score?
So, you know, Tim, just for those who don't watch our USC show here at the Voice of College Football, Tim's more Mr. Sunshine. I'm more dark rain clouds. And, you know, I've lived in Seattle for 20 years. So I guess maybe it's the rain that just kind of gets into my thought process and my metaphors and whatnot. But I do think USC wins. I'm going to say that off the top. But I think it's going to be a really rough, bumpy ride. I do think it's going to be a slugfest. And Michigan fans know when USC and Michigan play in a big game, it's usually a rock fight. 10-3, 1970 Rose Bowl, Bo's first trip to Pasadena for the granddaddy. 14-6 in 1977, 17-10. And of course, that's with USC actually just scored 10 points because USC did fumble on the one, and that was not a touchdown for the Trojans. So really, it was a 10-10 game. So like when these guys play, it's usually a rock fight. I mean, it was a rock fight in the first half of the 2007 Rose Bowl before USC broke it open in the second half. So I'm going with a rock fight. And, you know, Tim's point about USC can't settle for field goals, I think there's a nuance there. USC, if USC has a touchdown, like the ball is on your hands, like, you know, Saquon Barkley last night with the Eagles, like, okay, catch the ball. You got to make that play. But I mean, if Michigan plays great defense and USC has to settle for three, might not be the worst thing in the world for USC. USC can't shank chip shot field goals the way it did against LSU. So, you know, we saw the Giants and Commanders play an 18-18 tie before Washington then won. Washington didn't score a single touchdown. To me, I'm thinking 15-12 USC. I think we're going to see a lot of three-pointers in this game. I think we're going to see very few touchdowns. Getting three more than zero is going to matter, I think. You know, so, you know, hopefully Lincoln Riley won't have a Dan Lanning or Nick Sirianni moment where he's going for it on fourth and four from the 13, doing something really dumb. I don't think Lincoln Riley will do that. So like 3 points to me, I think are going to be valuable in this game. It's going to be a 1970s style battle. And with USC being in the Big Ten, I guess there's something poetic about that. So the only other thing is, I've already said, you know, turnovers are going to be key. Let me make one added note about turnovers. High impact turnovers. What do we define as a high impact turnover? I think this gets under discussed in football analysis. You know, if you commit a turnover in the red zone, either one, your red zone or the other team's red zone, that directly leads to points. That's a high impact turnover. But if you have third and 15 at your own 30 and you throw a bomb and it gets intercepted, you know, that's an arm punt. That's not a high impact turnover. So really, when we talk about turnovers, don't just look at the numbers. Are there high impact turnovers that create a 10-point swing, a 7-point swing? Those are the kinds of things that we really need to look at is going to be the kinds of moments that are going to decide this game if they happen. And if none of them happen, then it's advantage USC.
Did you give a score, Matt?
15-12. 15-12 USC.
Do you think this is SEC?
That's almost what DeReal MVP.
Miles Nick Saban, 2011. Yes.
DeReal MVP, resident provocateur and regular caller, said 9-6. So
this could be the ugliest win ever. I'll take it as long as we have one more point.
How many points did Texas score?
31.
Was that in Texas or was that in Michigan?
It was in Michigan, and Texas is better. Texas is better than USC right
but
now.
But Texas isn't a couple touchdowns better than USC on offense. Sorry, that's incorrect. I'm not talking about the defense. I'm talking about the offense. You're saying Texas is a couple touchdowns better than USC on offense?
I'll settle for a 3-2 win. Little Auburn, Mississippi State, 2008.
Yeah, anyone's going to settle for a win.
I'll take 6-4 Iowa Penn State back in the day.
There we go.
Well, I know you guys soon have to go prep for your show, so let's rock through our predictions here real quick. TJ, we'll start with you on how you think the game's going to go.
So I'm currently 3-0 in my predictions for Michigan, and what I am predicting this Saturday is a 28-17 USC victory. That's my prediction.
Hope you're 4-0.
Yeah. I don't. I'll take my L. I would like to lose. I'll take my L. Hope Michigan wins, though.
I'm going 23-17 USC. I just don't think we're going to be able to keep them to that magic 20 number. And I do think they're going to cobble enough together with Alex Orji, but I just don't think it's going to be quite enough. But hey, we've laid out the five ways that Michigan can pull it off. So stay tuned, because I don't think this is going to be the 50. Somebody predicted 52-6. I don't think that's happening. So the truth is somewhere in the middle, and I think we'll be, it's going to be a great game, guys. I'm looking forward to it. So we really want to thank both of you for coming on. So I definitely want to encourage all, we have multiple hundreds of people watching this across Michigan channel, USC channel, Twitter. And so I want to encourage every single one of you to go over in about a half an hour to Trojan Conquest Live, 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific, and check it out. Let's put the link. I don't know, Jackson's here, but I'll put the link here as well for everybody to directly just head straight there. But let's get a final thought. And where can people find you? And we'll start with Matt, since we started with you before. We'll start with you to wrap up here too.
Well, let's just give our lineup for here on the USC channel at the Voice of College Football. So obviously coming up tonight in half an hour, but then we're going to do our call-in show usually on Fridays, but Tim's going to be flying up to Ann Arbor on Friday. So we're going to do our call-in show Wednesday night. That's tomorrow, 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific. Tim and I are going to be on probably for 2 hours. So that's our call-in show. And then you want to come on over to our written work. Look at our written work over at Trojans Wire. That's trojanswire.usatoday.com. And we're working with Wolverines Wire all this week. So these two College Wire network sites. Yeah, Isaiah Hull of Wolverines Wire does a great job over there. Nice. So we're collaborating with him. He's asking us questions. We're asking him questions. So the answers are getting published at each of our sites all this week. So Trojans Wire, Wolverines Wire, part of the USA Today College Wire Network. Give us a read. Tell your friends.
All right. So thanks for joining us, Matt. And I'll be watching you in just a few minutes here.
Thank you, guys. And we really enjoy being on your show.
Thanks for having us. All right. And let's go to Tim now. For your final thought, and where could people find you? And again, I'm encouraging everybody, please go ahead. I put the link in there to Trojans Wire. Check out the written work and check out the show in less than a half an hour. Tim, floor is yours.
Well, I just said this is a really special event for me. As soon as I found out USC was entering the Big Ten, the first school I thought of was Michigan. Just being able to play University of Michigan, blue blood, so much history, you know. It's funny, not that many games, but there's a lot of history between these two schools. And it's just, you know, two private schools. Two schools that I think of you guys compared to some of the other schools. I'm not going to name as more of a private school than you are. But appreciate you guys having me on. But you know, I got family in Michigan, and I love Michigan. I've followed. Talk about your helmet games. This is going to be one of the all-time helmet games. And when I heard USC was playing in Ann Arbor for obvious first time in my lifetime, going all the way back to the 1950s, I knew I had to be there. So I think it's going to be a great game. I'm excited. I'm going to be on the sidelines shooting pictures. So if you want to find me, the first place is always at Trojans Wire There's going to be, I have a lot of photo galleries. So even if you're a Michigan fan, come check it out. I'll have plenty of pictures of Michigan as well in those galleries. You can also find me on Instagram, Tim_Prangley, again, where I post a lot of my game pictures. And then you can find me on Twitter, same thing, Tim_Prangley. And then Matt covered all the stuff at the Voice College Football. So yeah, be a great game. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, thanks, Tim. Yeah, excellent show. Great job, and looking forward to the Saturday.